What's going on, everybody? This is Brother Duane with this very, very special episode of the Biblical Hebrew Awakening podcast. I got a special guest here with me. I have HebrewGyalJo YouTube channel with me. And today we're going to basically discuss some things that have been on our heart. It's been an awesome journey going through this process in Yah to find out who we are as Eva Israelites and to learn the truth that's been suppressed for so long. As many of you know, we are now in the Day of Atonement, which goes from the evening of September 29th through the evening of September 30th. But right now, I want to go ahead and introduce HebrewGyalJo. Welcome. And do you have anything you want to say to your listeners and those that view your channel?
Yes, I want to first say thank you, Brother Duane and Biblical Hebrew Awakening, for reaching out to me. I was truly honored for the invite, and I'm excited to be here, and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Awesome, awesome. So, like, for you, you know, one of the first things I want to discuss is, you know, how did you come into the awakening that you are a Eva Israelite, that you're a Hebrew Israelite? How did you come to that truth? How did it sink in for you?
That is a very, very interesting story. It started when I was young, because I was raised kind of as a Hebrew or Eve and not even realizing that we were. I'm the youngest of three children. My father, and my mom, they all grew up in, you know, Christianity, keeping the same holidays and stuff like that. My parents got married, and then my dad started studying in the early 80s and realizing all that stuff was pagan. So he came out of it. Yeah, he came out of the pork. He came out of all that stuff. And by the time I was born in 87, that's when he was completely out of it. So my sister, my brother, they had like, one or two Christmases or whatever, but I've never had any. I grew up not eating pork. I grew up, not wearing pants. You know, some people kind of, vary on that subject. But that's how I grew up. But I was still in the church, and we grew up keeping the Sabbath and everything. My dad used to have a church when we was younger. Wow. And we kept the seventh day Sabbath. Yeah, exactly. But back in 94, when he was doing it, won't nobody really feeling that Sabbath worship. So it was a challenge. And then after, a few years, whatever, it kind of dwindled out, and he still preaches, but he's more in evangelism instead of pastoring now. So, I grew up and got big and bad and, went to college and went to the Kojic church. And for me, I came back, started wearing my pants. I started eating not too much pork, but I started eating shellfish and, doing all those things. But I still never really did Christmas because it wasn't a big deal for me. And then after a few years in the church, I was like, okay, this is getting old. Like, because all I heard was, I'm so sorry, I'm not worthy, but I'm glad he loves me. Right. And it was just the same old story. And I was like, yo, why we keep hearing the same thing? Who is growing? Like, everybody was just saying, I'm just thankful God paying my light bill. And I'm like, that's good, but what else? Like, it has to be more to this, And so I started falling away from the church, but still having a relationship with the Father. And then I came back into Miles Monroe. Like, I grew up listening to him a little bit as a child, but yes. I started listening to him. He was teaching on the kingdom. I was in love. I mean, everything about my life changed, when I realized the kingdom. Still hadn't tapped into the Hebrew aspect of it, but started understanding kingdom. And then, unfortunately, he died later that year after I came back into him. So I was like, devastated. I was like, dang, God, as soon as I find somebody that I can link with, you take them from me. So I was really upset. And so I just kind of like was just here and there and still studying the scriptures and all that, but just not really attending any church, just kind of at my own home and just going over it myself. And then at work, with my previous job, I would listen to YouTube videos because, we kind of had a loose atmosphere. We can kind of listen to videos and get our work done. Mm-hmm. And so I don't even know how, but I stumbled upon this this video of these, I'm sure everybody's seen this, plenty of white people that was saying, Black Americans, you are God's chosen. And this one girl, she was like, I would give my left foot to be God's chosen. And I was like, girl, bye, you crazy. Like, everybody chosen. We believe in Jesus. Right? We good. I said, she's stupid. So I turned it off. This was in like fall 2015. And then literally a year after that, that date, I came back on that same video. And I was like, why I keep running into this? And so something about it just triggered me this time. So I was like, let me see what she got to say. So I listened to it all the way out. And I was like, okay, this is pretty interesting. Pretty cool to see white folk actually praising Negroes. I'd never heard that before in my life. And so that's what led me into the Hebrew on the Corner videos, which was very extreme. kind of hilarious, but at the same time, I did learn some things. Right. And so from there, I just started like dabbling in, well, I don't say dabbling, but I started like researching other people. And I started trying to find people that I can listen to that was teaching what I knew, what I figured was true, because I saw it in the scriptures at that point, but I wanted the spirit to be right. And so that's how I got here. And, you know, I also was already a person that just loved trying to figure out who I was. Like, where did I come from? I didn't know I was going to find all this. I was happy with just being an Igbo. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't care. I didn't look for nothing spectacular that can rule over people and that like that. But I was, you know, surprised to come upon this. And then I realized how it was already what I was doing. So I said, this is, should be easy, you know? And then I just started incorporating the feast days and things of that nature. But yeah, so that's what got me to where I am.
Amen. Amen. That's awesome. That's an awesome testimony.
Thank you.
Yeah, it truly is. Yeah, for myself, you know, I've always felt subconsciously that Black people in America, and this is before I had the deeper revelation that it's not just, you know, us in America, but it's deeper than that, obviously. But mm-hmm. I always had the feeling and understanding that we were the Israelites, because the level of oppression and beat down is so over the top. It's the level of hatred for us is so bad that, you know, you're like, we must have did something really bad, you know?
Right.
And so that was a reoccurring theme. I mean, I'm basically 40 years old right now. And so, throughout my life over the past 30 something years, that's something that just kind of kept nagging me in the back of the mind, like, yeah, I don't know what's going on, but yeah, because we got it bad. Like, what, basically, like, I mean, what the hell did we do to deserve right. this level of beatdown? And mm-hmm. I got to keep honest and say it that way. Like, what did we do? Because,
right.
you know, our great grandparents, our grandparents, our parents, and even us. You know, I remember being a 17-year-old kid walking down. I was in Sacramento, California, and I was just going downtown with a buddy of mine. We're two Black brothers walking down, you know, mm-hmm. trying to just have some fun and talk to the girls and meet other brothers and stuff like that. And it was like a downtown market type thing, like Thursday night market, whatever. Mm-hmm. And next thing I know, we're just having a good time. Next thing I know, I got the cop on the horse rolling up on me and my brother right here. I'm hemmed up against the wall. We got reports you got a gun. Wow. I'm like, what? So, you know, I've wow. even experienced some various things from a young age. And yeah. it's all just consistently been like, okay, what's going on? So then... you know, getting older, I have to say probably my early 20s, I had a real great tug on my heart to really get in the scriptures, like really get in the scriptures. And so I just started to devour the word. I started devouring the scriptures. I mean, mm-hmm. I read my Bible, the New Testament, the Old Testament, Proverbs, everything. I read everything I could. And I almost felt the unction I received was that my life depended on it.
Wow.
And so here we are now, fast forward. I remember my wife and I were, it's about maybe 2.5 years ago, maybe 3. Mm-hmm. And my wife out of nowhere was saying, we messed up. And I'm like, excuse me? She's like, no, like as a people, like we must have really messed up. We must have did, we like, I'm gonna keep it real, like we must have pissed God off somehow, like, because right. there's no reason why we should be, as a people, should be going through the level of beat down and oppression that we see going on. And this right. is before all this stuff that's been going on, like this, you know, it's real yeah. bad now, and it was bad back then. So we started thinking about that, and I got in my spirit, man, Deuteronomy 28.
Wow.
And so I went there with my wife. And so my wife and I went to Deuteronomy 28 and we read it, and it was solidified yeah. right there for us that, okay, yeah, we're the people, we're the Israelites. And it wasn't even right. that big deal. It wasn't like a big, like, oh, moment. It was like, that's it. Okay. That yep. makes sense now.
I knew it.
Okay. That's it. All right. There you go. And you mm-hmm. just moved on from there. And so what's sad though is that how could you, this is what happened for me, how could you have that revelation that you're the Israelites? And you mm-hmm. get the confirmation, everything lines up, it's done. You don't nobody got to convince you. You don't got to pull out no other scriptures, no DNA evidence. You don't need none of that. Yeah. You know you're the Israelites because your life and the life of your people matches prophecy straight up.
Right.
So you're like, okay, I'm sold, done. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. And so that being said, it was a situation where now we stayed in Christianity. So it's kind of odd. It's like, we've been raised Christians. We believe in Jesus. And I think what made it difficult, which goes into maybe the next topic, is we have encountered and experienced the power in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. I've seen miracles happen. I've seen things happen in the church. As wrong as the church is, I've seen the spirit of Yah move in the church, as corrupt and jacked up as it is. And so this goes into the next area of topic that I like to hit on before we go into our main topic is, you know, how can we reach and wake up our brothers and sisters in the church, because in Christianity, okay? Because I don't think there's anything wrong with being a Christian. This is me personally. There's nothing wrong being a Christian. I mm-hmm. still consider myself to be a Christian, mm-hmm. As meaning a follower of the Messiah. I acknowledge my heritage as a Eve Israelite and all that goes along with that. And there's a greater burden on being an Eve Israelite than just being a general Christian, because Christianity perverts the truth of the scriptures.
Right.
And that's what the problem lies. The problem is not in being a Christian. Mm-hmm. The problem lies in Christianity, in that you have pastors and ministers that are leading congregations, some of which know the truth, most of which probably don't. I'm talking specifically the black church, but mm-hmm. it's the traditions of men. It's a business. It's money making. It's all these various mm-hmm. things. It's just like what we do, our traditions. Right. And so I even look at by myself or my wife and I, we recognize, okay, we're the Israelites. That seals it. That's what it is. But did not take accountability for being a Hebrew. Yeah, being an Israelite. Because there's now, I mean, you're in the state you're in for a reason. Why don't you go find out why?
Right.
Versus just mm-hmm. putting money in on the altar or in the hand of the pastor. So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, what are your thoughts transitioning to essentially reaching our brothers and sisters that are in the Christian church? And this also, I mean, we got to deal with our own folks first, but this mm-hmm. also deals with the companions of Israel that are going to be mm-hmm. engrafted in or are engrafted in through Messiah. They right. eventually are going to have to grab a hold of this truth as well. But let's just deal specifically with our own people for right now. What is your thoughts on that? Just go for it. Floor is yours.
Well, that's another interesting question. The thing is that, okay, this is how I look at it. I feel like in the church, there's two different types of people. This is just me personally. I observe those who go to church because of the fact that it's, you know, my good deed, you know, it's my one thing that's going to keep me from hell. And it's entertaining, it's fleshy, you know, it feels good. And then there's those that actually put in the work outside of the church, that study and that pray and that live right, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think when it comes to waking them up, like for me, that was a hard part for me too, because like you said, I've seen stuff in the name of Jesus. Ain't nobody going to tell me now. You ain't going to tell me what I've seen. So it was hard to adjust to saying like, wait, what do you mean Jesus don't mean nothing? You know, but I had to come to the realization that it's not so much that, okay, let me say it like this. I knew when I was growing up, I never looked at the white image of Jesus and said, okay, that's him. Because when I read in the scriptures, for me, I just didn't picture that when I hear how he spoke. I didn't look at that and say, okay, that must be him. I just said, okay, this is another thing that white people are doing. You know, this is just how I was thinking as a child, that they're doing to make themselves feel more comfortable. It wasn't a big deal. But I feel like once you realize, and once you go to the church and you present to them, hey, it's not that we're saying to not believe in the Messiah. We want you to believe in the true Messiah. And once you know the true Messiah, then you can understand what it is that he really said. because that's the issue. Is they have this carbon copy kind of Messiah that has a very similar message, but very different and very dangerous. And so when you tell them to change what you believe, don't believe in Jesus, they're thinking, oh my God, if I deny the Messiah, I'm automatically going to hell, you know? And so that's the issue for me. I had to realize I'm not denying my faith in the Messiah and the belief for the Messiah, you know, because I am what people would call messianic, but it was actually understanding what he actually said and not just saying, okay, he's a black man, so that makes him, you know, his skin was black. Yes, that's just that's just decoding another lie. But I'm not saying it to say, oh well, he's black, so that makes him automatically righteous because his skin is black. Like, right. Everybody was black in those days, so it's not right. Surprising that he was black. It has nothing to do with skin color.
Everybody was black,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. But it was just when you understand what he actually said and you realize that this new creation is saying something totally different, that's when you need to start, okay, wait a minute. Now I know there's two different parallels. Now which one am I going to follow? Am I going to be that person that just wants to keep going just for the sake of going? Or am I going to be that person that actually is like, you know what? No, I really do mean right. Let me do right. You know? And that's pretty much what it is. You just have to flip-flop it to me. The holidays, stop doing the holidays and keep the feast days. It's, you're still doing the same practice, but you're just changing the method. Like, you know, you're still going to worship once a week sometimes, you know, but your day is Saturday, not Saturday. It's not Sunday. You see what I'm saying? So I think that's where Christians kind of get hung up. It's like, you feel like, okay, you give me this whole new gospel. You give me this whole new God. And that's what happened back when Constantine Christianity came into place. That's what they actually did to you. You just don't realize it.
Right.
Man, you know, so that's
you're hitting on some nuggets right there. You're hitting on some nuggets. Some truth bombs right there. You're hitting it. Yeah. Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen. Like, that's real talk right there, because, you know, it's the devil's so slick. And I'm actually preparing a video. I've been holding off for a while because it's going to be gangster. I mean, it really is. Because we have this Western, this Eurocentric, white, messianic Jesus image that honestly does not line up with the scriptures.
It doesn't.
And the commentary does not line up with the scriptures. And so there's, you know, I'll keep it simple. So basically what I've seen is that the Eurocentric Western white church has hijacked the true Christianity.
Absolutely.
Repackaged it. And then they've reinterpreted it to mean what they want it to mean.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you get scriptures where it's like, okay, so this is what it is, because of lack of understanding, and is also messing with their demonic system, because it is demonic, which is crazy. Mm-hmm. When you get the actual biblical scriptures where Messiah, Jesus Christ, is pointing to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
He's always pointing to the Father. Always.
Right.
And yet in Christianity, what's happened is, this is really what it is. It is antichrist, and it's just evil to the core. I mean, it's the deception. It's crazy, because basically what they've done is this. They've basically created an alternate version of Gnosticism.
Right.
Where, like, it's like the most gangster, sneaky Gnosticism that there ever was, because they're saying, we're not like the Gnostics, we're not like the heretics, we're not like these people, yet they really are, because they deny Yah of the Old Testament, they deny Elohim, deny the Father, they deny the Father, and they also deny Yah, like the Messiah in the Old Testament, because oftentimes where they say, you know, that there's issues of you know, no one's seen God, the type of thing, but really they don't understand that Yah used his messengers, and he all, like, you know, the angel of the Lord, and he also used a kind of pre-incarnate Messiah to do things. So there's a lot that people just don't understand, and that's fine, because I'm still learning, we're all learning. But what they've done in this Christianity is they've made the Son the all of everything. Basically, there is no Father. Jesus is everything. He is the one and only. That's it. Mm-hmm. And I even know right now, there's some Christians right now that are cringing right now when I say that, because they've been conditioned that everything is just Jesus, 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 Jesus. And it is, but the problem is that the devil has used your adoration of the Messiah. You basically made the Messiah an idol, which is that sounds crazy. That sounds crazy because basically what I mean by that is you have basically separated the Son from the Father and the Father from the Son. And you can't do that.
Right.
You can't do that. Basically, Christianity does not want you to have the Father. They don't want you to know about the Father. They don't want you to know about the ways of the Father. They might as well just throw the Old Testament away, but they won't do that because all the blessings are based out of the covenant.
Right.
So they want the covenant blessings without the covenant responsibility.
Right. Oh, that's a good point. I didn't really even catch it that way. But you're right. You're absolutely right. That's exactly what they do.
Yeah, I mean, it blows my mind. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say and I'm not bashing anybody that's a Christian like that, but for me, you can always tell those ones that don't really. No, this is just me talking.
Yeah, I got you.
Okay. For me, I can tell those Christians that really don't want to deal with the truth of whether it be black or white or anything that doesn't really want to deal with the truth of the Old Testament, because every time you talk to them, they only quote New Testament. And I'm just like, everything that y'all need is always found in the New Testament, which is odd to me because I'm like, so what's the point of having the other half of the book if you don't even study it? Like, you never, ever, ever reference it, ever.
Right.
You know, that's confusing to me. But it makes sense because once you go back into the Old Testament, then there's some truths that you can't deny. And it's going to have to cause you to change everything you've been saying. And that's what I'm doing. Like when I was in the quote, Christian way, not knowing that nothing about, because I didn't even know, like I remember hearing about the Israelites and when we were kids, we used to joke about like when we were growing up, we would keep the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And my brother, I remember him joking like, we not Jewish. We ain't no Jews. Why are we doing this? Yep. And now I laugh back at that now because I'm like, we really were. But,
that is actually pretty funny.
it's hilarious. Like, it was funny back then because I was like, we ain't no Jew. Why are we doing this? But now I'm like, no, we were so ignorant. Like, we really didn't know. But, it's just, I grew up, only focus solely on the New Testament because I didn't understand the Old Testament. For me, in my mind, I didn't understand it because I saw the Israelites as a group of people that existed back then. They did not exist now. I never considered that they had descendants. Everybody else in the world, I was like, oh yeah, they passed down. We understand, King Louis and, all these different people from back in the day, King Louis, they had descendants and that's why they still have people on the throne today in England. I never considered that the Israelites had descendants, like never crossed my mind until like a year ago. And I felt so stupid because I used to be like, oh, Hebrew is, it's a language. It's not a people. And people used to tell me, no, you're wrong. But they never told me why I was wrong, which is also aggravating. But that's another thing. But, that's to me, that's why I feel like with Christians that want to keep that whole, like, I don't have to honor God's people. Or I don't have to honor the Father and what he said. I don't have to listen to what he said. They only say in the New Testament, which is odd to me.
Right.
You might as well not even have a Bible.
Right. And what's crazy to me is this, is that if people actually were to study even the New Testament, they would understand that the majority of the New Testament is quoting the Old Testament verbatim.
Yes, you're so right. It's almost like a tape recorder, like you're just replaying.
Right. Like it's quoting like literally, especially the Septuagint, it's like literally quoting verbatim what was back in the Old Testament.
Right.
In the New Testament. So how are you denying the root of all things? and basically what it is this is what gets me now is that you have again the Eurocentric Western Christianity wants to make it out as though the Eves were some mystical people that don't exist no more.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's like, okay, so it makes you wonder, like, subconsciously or even consciously, y'all got to know the truth. Mm-hmm. Because, so basically it's like, oh, they're lost. The 10 tribes are lost. And the only folks that are around is the Jewish people, which then leads into the other issue, which is what I've seen. And I got a crazy story on this one. It's been the Zionist movement and this whole kind of Zionist worship within the Christian church where you have like your John Hagee type situation.
Oh,
where,
God.
you got Eurocentric Christianity worshiping the Jewish nation. you know, the nation state of Israel. They worship them people.
They do.
And that's what it is. I mean, they straight up have made the Jewish people their own idol. Mm-hmm. That's insanity to me. So let me tell you a quick story here. So my wife and I, my kids, I got two kids. I got a boy and a girl. And we went to this church. Right now I'm in San Antonio. And we went to this church. I won't go too deep, but they'll know. Anybody that's listening from San Antonio will know what I'm talking about. So anyway, John Hagee has his big mega church up here. And we're part of this ministry. And they were invited to go to this church, John Hagee's church. And it was like the Christians United for Israel type thing, right?
Yeah, Kufi. I know what you're
talking
about.
Yeah, right? So we went out there. Now, this is crazy. This is crazy. So, you know, my wife and I, we know that we're Israelites, but we kind of, I guess, suppressed it. And we're like, oh, whatever. We're just going to go. We're still, you know, Christians, right? Mm-hmm. So we go to the church. And there's like mad crazy security. It's like FBI, CIA, you know, stuff going on, like escorts and bodyguards and folks in suits and you know, things going on. So we find our seats, we get in there, and essentially the rule was you could not mention the name of Jesus.
Yep, I have a story too, but go ahead.
I want to hear your story. So but basically you couldn't mention the name of Jesus, right? Now, mind you, the church that we were visiting and attending, they're a messianic church, a mixed messianic church. They rolling with Jesus. You talking about, right? They know the power of Messiah. Y'all tripping. So we get there, and literally the people, the ministers that are getting up, the different people that are getting up to just make speeches about pro-Israel, you know, Zionist type stuff, they're basically dancing around the name of Jesus. In the name and Hashem and all this kind of stuff, right?
Yeah.
And the Messiah is so ingrained in us in Christianity, regardless.
Exactly.
It's in you. Like, you ain't going to just, like, drop off the Messiah. So there's this pastor that got up there, and he was giving a speech, and he almost slipped. And he caught himself. It is making me mad right now, but he slipped. It was funny, and it makes me sad at the same time. He almost slipped to mention the name of Jesus. He stopped himself, corrected himself, and just said, in your holy name, or, you know, some generic whatever. And we got mad in the congregation, like, that were out there. Somebody, you know, he was visiting that church we were kind of a part of. He stood up and said, what about Jesus? Because it was like making you mad, because he's like, you got these folks sitting there, like, why are you dancing around? Just because these Jews rolled up in the scene, now you're denying Jesus? So now the scripture pops up that, you know, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before the Father. You got these folks in San Antonio at this church denying the Messiah off some Jews. And they ain't even Hebrews.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy. That's crazy. On top of that, and I'll stop because I get amped up. On top of that, they straight up were handing these Jewish people mad money, like $10,000, $25,000, $50,000. They were funneling cash to these folks, and they had nerve to be so snooty and arrogant that they did not want to even shake John Hagee's hand.
Wow.
They look like, oh man, it's a Sabbath, so I gotta just kind of calm down. But they look like, they look like, please, like, you know what I want to say? They look like
ninja, please.
They look like, get out of here. Like, I can't even be by. I wouldn't spit on you if you was on fire. Like, they look like the only reason why I'm here is to collect a check.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a smile and I'm a bounce. That's the only reason why I'm here. Like, all y'all go away, could die. That's how they looked at everybody that been there. So you got these folks in this mega church basically have made these Ashkenazi Jewish people idols. It was crazy. Mm-hmm. It was crazy. Mm-hmm. And then the fact that they literally were dancing around the name of the Messiah. Even like the English Jesus Christ. They wouldn't even say that. So we were shocked and appalled, and that messed us up for a while, that there's Christians that worship the Jewish nation so much that they will deny the Messiah to side with the Jews. So I want to hear your story. What was your story? I'm just, man, that just bothered me.
It's It's actually the same because I was going to a church. This was back in, I think, like 2008 or 9 or something like that. And I was at a Kojic church. And so, well, I'm not sure if you know if you're familiar with it, but Kojic is very, Holy Ghost driven.
You
And,
got a Christ? Yes.
yes. So you know where they are. And so they had brought in the pastor, they had brought in Kufi and John Hagee. And so we remember before the service came, they were giving us directives, same way you had, like you told us, with like you were saying with the FBI. I mean, it was just like this huge, or I mean, you would have thought Jesus literally was showing up. Like, it was a huge production. I was so confused. I'm like, who are these white people? Like, I'm not trying to be rude, but I didn't understand because, like, for me growing up, I didn't understand. I knew that there were Jewish people, but I didn't actually think that people actually believed that they were the chosen people of God because, in my mind, everybody in the Bible is black. When I read it, it reads like black people to me. So I didn't
You already
really.
know this, yeah.
Yeah, so I didn't look at that and say, okay, well, they're Jewish, yeah, and I know they don't, for the most part, they didn't believe in Jesus, so I didn't rock with them like that because I was, Jesus only at that time, so to speak. But I didn't think people actually thought they were like descendants of God's people. Like, that just didn't make sense to me until I started coming into this faith and this understanding. So anyway, so we get to the service and we're going over Hebrew songs. I mean, I still remember the Hebrew song in my head. Like, it's just almost like enchanting. It was just so crazy how I still remember that. And so we couldn't say Jesus. They took down posters in the church that had Jesus' name on it. They
Oh
took,
my God.
they removed, I'm not lying, they removed
Are
everything. They
you
gave us a certificate.
serious?
I honest to the Lord, to
Oh
Yah
my
above,
goodness.
they took it
That's
down.
out of
They
control.
out of control. They took down any everything, like, just a little dove with Jesus is Lord and Holy Spirit. They took down everything.
Wow. Oh,
Yes. And we had a congregation and
wow.
I was. And I'm on the praise team and I'm singing this song and I'm sitting here looking like, it was nice and fun. But then I'm like, where are these, these white people are in here and we're doing all of this for them. And I'm like, this is odd to me. Like, I don't understand why are we, you're
Oh
in
my
our
goodness.
sanctuary, our church,
Oh.
but yet we're changing how we do things for you. And I don't even know who you are. Like, that's literally how I was thinking. And
Wow.
I was upset because I'm like, we can't say Jesus. Like, it was the same exact thing. And I'm like,
Oh
wow.
wow.
And now, when I look back on it, I'm looking at that night like, seriously, that this, now I understand what it is. I'm like, man, we now I get why I was so mad, but it's even more like upsetting to know that this is false. These are fakes. And our people did all of that for them. And we, on top of that, are the true heroes. That was so upsetting to me. So yeah, I know exactly what you mean. I was right. And they had loads of money that they gave to. And I don't know if they did it on purpose or they just didn't know and they were trying to be respectful. I don't know, but I didn't like it either.
No, I think they knew. I mean, look, I'm sorry. I don't care who you are. There's no way I'm gonna deny the Messiah for no man.
Right. That's true.
That bothered me so. And to this day, it still bothers me because you got to really just like let that sink in. You have massive amounts of people. I mean, it had to be at least, oh man, it was at least 5,000 people in this particular sanctuary, and
Wow.
they were denying the name of Jesus before the Ashkenazi Jews, and then got nerve to give them money that they looked at them like, y'all could die for all I
Yeah.
care. I just want your money and I'm bouncing. That's
Yeah.
all I
We
really care about.
did not, our people did not connect with their people at all. Like, at all. They were with their group, and our group was with our group. I don't recall there ever being, I didn't shake anybody's hand. I didn't meet John Hagee. I didn't do nothing, and normally, how our people are when we see televangelists, we go crazy.
Oh,
And
yeah.
so we weren't, I mean, there was no intermingling. It was
Wow.
crazy.
Wow. And then that we'll save this for a different topic, but that's something we got to definitely delve into in regards to just Christianity, the deception of Christianity. And I know that someone is hearing me say that right now, and they're just like, oh my gosh, like, you know what I mean? Like it's messing with them. But the reality is when they have to just be still and look at the facts that Christianity is a deception that many of us, most of us, have come in through. Yet I want you to understand that just because I'm saying that Christianity is a deception does not mean or does not negate the truth of what the Messiah and the Father has done in your life. It does not deny what the Ruach has been able to speak to your life or impart into your life. It does not take away from your salvation or none of that kind of stuff. It's just to understand that there's a level of deception that we all have been brought up under. And that being said, I want to caution my Hebrew Israelite brothers and sisters that just because you're now in this truth, you were not always in this truth and the level of understanding you currently have. So have some love and compassion when you're speaking to people about these truths, because again, this is very difficult for many people to fathom and understand that they've been brought up into a major deception.
Yeah.
A deception of deceptions, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, and now it's time to wake up. Mm-hmm. It's time to wake up, not only for the Eve Israelites to wake up around this world and to reconnect and find out who they are truly, but also for the Gentiles that have been engrafted in. It's important for you to understand the truth, to receive the truth, and move on. Don't get hung up and stuck. I see these people, you know, they are focused on the most craziest things. They get caught up on the flat earth. They get caught up on Nibiru, you know, Planet X, the latest, you know, Illuminati scandal, possibility, Antichrist. Everybody and their mom is the Antichrist. You know, there's so much chaos in the world, you know. We understand that we are living in the end of the age, so to speak. This is it. We understand that. We are, this is it. And the final move of Yah is to waken his people up. Not no spiritual people, not some like this weird replacement theology move that Christianity has done, which basically is what it comes down to. This is what Christianity is. They deny the Father for the Son. Mm-hmm. They have molded the Son in their image, which is just happens to be a white Eurocentric image. Mm-hmm. And he's a big old teddy bear. He just loves everybody. You want to keep him as a baby or as a lamb and not as a lion of the tribe of Judah.
Exactly.
Right. They want to, you know, they, and also, again, you have the deeper, darker aspect of it that we won't go into tonight. But bottom line, is this something where that could be a message all by itself is talking about that. But you have any last words on that topic about our people and even the Gentiles in the Christian church before we move on to repentance for our Eve Israelite nation?
Well, I'll piggyback on what you said. It's just that, you know, we have to have compassion for those who are still in it. Because like I said, for me, the way I see it is you have those who are playing church and you have those who are serious, but they don't understand what has happened. You know, they don't know yet. So we can't just be like, oh, you're a Christian, you're in the church, I rebuke you. Like, how are we going to wake them up? Like, what's going to make them want to follow what you're saying if they know that all the interaction I had with you was, you know, you basically cursing them out or whatever. But, you know, I just, I'm just being nice. Right, exactly. Right, you know, that just
you can't be barking on the street at the people, man. Come on now, like, you got to stop all that. Like, oh, I got something to speak on that too, but finish up. I got something to say on that too, because that's, you know, you can't be barking and yelling at these people, calling them evil. You a Christian, you pagan.
Yeah.
You know, you devil, all this stuff. That, what you going to do? What you doing with that? Yeah. That ain't going to work.
Because a lot of them came out of Christianity, I'm pretty sure too. So that's just odd too. But I mean, even for the Gentiles, I just feel
crazy.
Like, exactly. But even into the Gentiles, I feel like as Israel is chosen to be, we're not just chosen because we're, you know, we're super cool and we look good. We're chosen because we have a job to do, you know,
right.
And we have a responsibility. And so we can't just go, oh, I'm chosen, leave it there. You know, we got to actually, okay, what am I supposed to do? Like, you get selected for the kickball team. Okay, I made the team. Now you got to go to work. You see what I'm saying?
Yep, what's so your position? What's supposed to do?
Exactly. You have to learn the game, all the rules, you know, all of that. You know, the rules equals the law, all of that stuff, you know? And so we have to teach the Gentiles, because that's what the scripture told us to do also. You know, we are supposed to be a light unto the Gentiles. And that's what we're chosen for, so that Yah's name and his ways will be made known on the earth amongst everybody, you Amen. Know? So, you know, I don't know. I just think it's crazy that they're all black theology. I'm not knocking anybody that believes that, but that doesn't make sense to me, because we're supposed to be reigning with the Messiah in the kingdom. But who are we ruling over if it's just us?
Right.
We can't rule over each other. We definitely ain't ruling over the Messiah. So I don't understand. Like, that doesn't make sense. But
that's right.
I don't know.
The Messiah is the king. He has his royal priesthood. He has his people in place that basically run the kingdom along with him. You know, that's why you see all the kings of the earth casting their crowns before his feet.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So, and it's something where also a challenge, and again, we'll move on to the main area of that repentance, but it's like a lot of Gentiles, they're like, everybody wants to be an Eve Israelite, but they don't want to be an Eve Israelite.
Mm-hmm.
And it transcends everything, because you even have it right now where you have anything that so-called black people do around this earth, everyone else imitates. We're always imitated. It don't matter what we say or do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It can be the most craziest, ridiculous thing, and next thing you know,
people are saying it
and everybody's doing it and everybody's mm-hmm. imitating it. And they're making money off of it. So this is the weird thing about it, is that, and I'm trying to get the scriptural backdrop of this too. But the way I see it right now is we are in a weird place where, as Eve Israelites, we operate in the blessing and the curse at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning it's not just total breakdown. It's almost worse than that, because that, you know, just total breakdown is it is what it is. You just broke down, you died, that's it. All right.
Yeah.
But it's worse than that, because it's like you're like the smartest, the strongest, the most creative. You make everything, you invent everything,
mm-hmm.
and then other people steal your work.
Right. It's not funny, but it is kind of fun.
But you know what I'm saying? Like, you have to laugh about it a little bit. I mean, yeah. So it don't matter. Yeah. Like music, like it's insanity.
Yeah.
Every genre of music in America, and that's also gone worldwide, is rooted off of Eve Israelite music. Mm-hmm. I don't care if it's metal, rock, mm-hmm. blues, jazz, classical music.
Yeah. You're right.
Like, it all is rooted, and I'm not discounting or discrediting the contributions of other nations. That's not what I'm saying. But the reality is, the dominant has been the Eve Israelite nation in everything, and their work just gets ripped off. They get stolen. Usually, American history, a white person gets credit for it. They get the patents for it, or they get the money.
Exactly.
You know,
all of the above.
Yeah. I mean, so it's amazing to see how we've been operating in that, which is pretty tragic, because it's like, oh brother, you got a good idea. I'm gonna go ahead and take the idea and make it work, and you're gonna still be broke. Thanks. It's like, oh man, are you for real, dude? You came over here and took my idea and made bank off of it, you know. But also that ties into the demonic kingdom and system, because the bottom line is that the demonic kingdom runs things on this earth. So you're not gonna get through that ceiling unless they want you to, or you basically sell out to enter in, and they'll just exploit you, give you a little bit of change, leverage you to exploit others, but you're still on the bottom. You've lost your soul. You know, what profit a man, right? You didn't sit there, you gained the whole world and lost your soul. Like, whack. So we have a job to do as an Eve Israelite nation. I will say this, and then we'll move on to the repentance part, and that is I've been developing a research project, and what I'm going to do, I'm going to open it up to you, Joe. I'm going to open it up to you to research. I'm going to open it up. I'm going to open it up to key people for right now. I think I'm going to have three versions. So what I'm going to have is, this is going to be a Google Drive that you personally can access. That's going to have tons of raw data and information. It's going to be categorized, that basically establishes and reinforces the extra biblical and also biblical proof of who we are as Eve Israelites.
Okay.
The second one is going to be for folks I don't trust, which is everybody else. Because look, I just know, I know the game, I know the hustle. even right now, eventually, the shadow government, the enemy, the Satan, and his goons are listening. They're watching.
Yeah.
And so I don't want to tip off my analytic research style.
Right.
So this is going to be what I'll present to like the general population of people that kind of, okay, that's cool. And then I'm gonna have information for you and other, basically, Israelite that are in the movement to waken our people, where they can be armed with information. So it doesn't matter if you're dealing with South American Eva Israelites or folks in Africa or in China or in wherever, you'll be armed with information where you can speak to all people.
Awesome.
And I'll also probably be teaching some classes on resource material, because I'll tell you this, the information is out there. It's been suppressed. And oftentimes they mask the names that they use to talk about this stuff.
Yeah.
So that the average person doesn't stumble upon it. Also, they'll just keep it in a foreign language. So it won't even be in English. It'll be in like Russian or German or something like that.
Yeah.
So like literally they're talking about it behind our back.
Wow. Yeah. But in like our face too.
Yeah, it's right. It's out in the open, but they're basically talking about it behind your back. You have no idea that they're writing massive 35-page documents talking about how you are the Eva Israelite nation.
Wow. I believe it and I understand that now, but every time I hear it, it's still shocking. Like, wow.
It is shocking that there's collusion that's going on. But okay, I'm going to drop a bomb. I'm going to drop a bomb right now and then we'll move on. All right. So I'm going to hit it. You're going to be like, oh, and then I'm going to move on. All right. Okay. So, I'll drop a little bit because it's rough. It's like an atomic bomb. I don't want to mess everybody up right now. They'll turn off. They'll be like, okay, I can't do this no more. Bottom line is I've been studying genetics and I have a lot of material to back up this genetic documentation. So basically what it comes down to is, I'll just say this, we've been lied to about who is the descendants of Shem and who the descendants of Ham and Japheth are. We've been lied to about that.
Okay, tell me more.
So I'll drop this nugget and I'll leave it at that and folks can go ahead and go from there. So essentially the line of Shem, the Shemitic line, is Y DNA haplotype group DE.
I've heard that before, yeah.
That is the true Shemitic line. Now, when it comes to the line of Ham and the line of Japheth, they have, let's put it this way, they've been corrupted. That line has been corrupted to varying degrees. And so there's been fallout because of that, so to speak. There's been basically a lot of intermixing. Also, take into account the fallen Elohim. Fallen Elohim also come into play in regards to inserting their genetics into the stream of mankind to corrupt mankind. So it gets deep. It gets deep because this goes into a level of my research where, let's just look at two things and I'll leave it at that. All right. Two things that Yah commanded his people to do was to stay holy as he is holy and to stay pure as a nation, right?
Exactly.
So they intermarried within themselves, which is the reason why our Y DNA haplotype is so huge, because we've honored Yah in that sense. So where everyone else was basically kind of free reign going at it with each other.
Yeah.
Okay. Also dealing with the Nephilim or the fallen Elohim, right? There you go. And so then the last part I'll say in this is in regards to what was the second thing that Yah had commanded Abraham to do? That was circumcision.
Right.
When you look worldwide at the nations that circumcise their children, Africa is number one at over 80% of the entire continent circumcises their children. That is not a practice native to the rest of the world. Now, the rest of the world does do it, but at a way lesser extent. And it's due to imitation, like everything else, versus authenticity. So when you look at the Torah, you look at prophecy, and then you look at the genetics, then you look at oral history, a story kind of unfolds for you. So like I said, I'll share my research with you and some of the other key people that will need to know this information. But okay, let's wrap this up so we're not here too long. It's been great talking to you, though. It's been a
same here.
Breath of fresh air. So I want to hear you speak about your thoughts on repentance as a Eve Israelite nation. Mind you, I'm not just talking about here in America. I'm talking about the all remnant. Over. Yes, the remnant as a remnant all over this world. What can we do? What needs to be done for us to, number one, waken our people up, and then also bring us to a Deuteronomy chapter 30 level of repentance and restoration?
Wow. Okay. So for me, I feel like this. In order to waken our people up, you know, like you said earlier, we have to start realizing and looking at where we are in life and start. And it can't just be like, we can't just accept it and be like, okay, well, you know, that's just how it always been. You know, I was wondering too myself before I came into this knowledge of the Israelites and that, you know, the Negro was the Israelite. I was like, okay, what's going on with black people? Like, what is wrong with us? Like, why are we always picked? Like, I just didn't understand racism because I was like, everybody else gets along, but nobody likes the black man. You know, I didn't understand that. And so I was in my mind, I was like, oh, maybe it's because, you know, and again, I'm not pushing a black theology or pushing black or nothing like that. But I was like, we all know that the black man, the man of color, the human, was first. And so I said, well, maybe since we were made in the image of Yah, that when the enemy sees us, and he's in the souls and working through those people who are not us, you know, there's an evil anger towards it because, you know, Lucifer and Satan, you know, he hated, you know, that was how I was thinking. And I was kind of on the same track, but not quite. And so when I came into it, I was like, wow, that is kind of sort of true, but it was a lot more to it. But I think as far as us, we have to understand why we have to first figure and come to the point where we are and be real about it and not accept it anymore and start questioning and start critically thinking, like, what is going on with us? Like, because we are the only people, no matter where we are the lowest in the totem pole, regardless. Right. And so once you do that, you have to start realizing, okay, this thing is not just about a bunch of people on the earth and there's no God, there's no order, there's no design, there's nothing. We're just all, because when you look at racism, that there has to be something higher than just everybody living on earth and there's no God and we just happen to poof up here. So once you come to that realization, then you have to start figuring out, well, who is this Elohim that we're supposed to be, you know, that's ordered this whole situation, that's ordering this whole like planet, this whole system that we're living in, because life is not just a journey or, you know, it's just about finding yourself. It's deeper than that, you know? And then once you do that, that's when you come into the Elohim of Israel. And then you find out what it is that he wants. And so basically what I'm saying is it gets to a point where we have to find out, okay, we're in a situation and we got to figure out why. And then once we do that, we got to be obedient as to how to get out of it. That's just the bottom line. It's not about, oh, well, I'm just going to do this because it's my interpretation or it don't take all of that, which is, you know, things that we heard growing up. I'll speak for myself, things I heard growing up in the church. You know, there's a way to do everything. There's an order to everything. And regardless, and if you like it or not, that's just how it is. I mean, we follow the procedure for filing a court case. We follow the procedure for filing a marriage or getting a license or going to college, financial aid. Like, there's a procedure for everything. And so, you know, if you want to get to B, you got to figure out where you got to start at A. And that's what our people have to do. But unfortunately, we still have a lot of stiff-necked people. And I'm not being rude, but we do. We have a lot of people that still want to do what they want to do, which is what got us in this situation. And the more we stay in that situation, the more our situation, and stay in that mindset, the more our situation is never going to change. But, you know, if you're comfortable with it being that way,
I'm not whatever. Comfortable.
No, exactly. But I'm going to say, nobody's comfortable.
To go. I'm ready to go. This place is garbage. Like, I'm done. Like, you know,
who you telling?
There's so many things you can talk about. You know, like I said, you got folks talking about Nibiru and Planet X and NASA lies and you know, all this other kind of stuff. And I'm like, look, we got to stop playing games, stop playing church. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to get up out of here.
Right.
It's time for Israel to get their act right. Right. So for all y'all, especially y'all Gentiles that are tired, sick and tired of this world, y'all need to grab the nearest brother and say, wake up.
Right.
Figure out become who you obedient. Are and get right with y'all. So we, like it says, the whole world groaneth. Like, we tired.
Yeah. Yeah.
We tired. It's time to go. I'm done. Like, look, whatever we got to do to wake the people up. Back to close out the last session. So my computer gave up the ghost. Too much bandwidth was jumping, so restarted on me. So I apologize for that. That being said, the power of video editing, what I will do is I will edit the video together as one piece properly. So it should be continuity. As I was saying, you know, with First John is a powerful book that is often overlooked, and it talks about love. It talks also about the commandments. This is New Testament. It talks about the commandments of Yah and the commandments of the Messiah, which are the commandments of Yah. So, you know, you're to love one another. And, you know, when you come into this truth, you can't just keep on sinning willfully. Just keep going down that path. That's not going to work. And so that's the problem that we have in Christianity is the deception is that you can keep on sinning and God will forgive you and you can just do whatever you want because, you know, God's a big old teddy bear. He knows your heart. You know, he knows you're trying. But when you look at the Old Testament, okay, which is just the whole thing is a covenant, but just for sake of discussion, when you look at the Old Testament and you even look at the chosen people of Yah, in Exodus 19 and 20, he tells the people certain rules, certain protocols to approach the mountain that he was going to be on. They couldn't even approach him or else they would die. They couldn't even touch the mountain. Not even an animal could touch the mountain or else it would die because Yah is holy and he has standards. So you could be his chosen people that he's entering into a covenant with and you will still die because there's rules and regulations and protocols. He is a Elohim of order. It don't matter who it is or what it is. He is about order and he's not going to violate his word and he's not going to violate that order. So it's something that as ever Israelites coming into the truth of who we are, we have to reframe our mindset. You're not throwing everything out that you've learned. Okay, but you have to reframe your mindset to that of one of covenant, which goes back to what you said with Miles Monroe, which was awesome because I love Miles Monroe as well, and his teaching series to get you under the mindset of covenant and laws.
Right. And he was the first one that I ever heard say that the Bible is a contract. And, you know, and of course we know it's covenants and stuff like that, but it's essentially the same thing. It's a law abiding agreement between two parties. And that's exactly what it is.
Exactly. So we have to learn. So obviously for us as Eva Israelites and those of us from all around the world, we're going to have to get into our history book. We have to, reread the scriptures from a truly personal Hebraic perspective. And I'll tell you for myself, looking at the scriptures from that perspective has opened my eyes up and it's put a greater unction of responsibility on me that, look, guess what, guy? There's something you have to do.
Yeah.
You know, because in Christianity, basically you're lazy. You're just living. You're just living. That's it. I mean, there's nothing really more to really say. You were just living, trying to be a nice person. I love Jesus. And you're just trying to be a nice person. And you're just floating through until the great by and by when you die and pray that your salvation was secure in Messiah. That's basically what it was. And I believe for those that have passed before us, there's a certain level of grace in their understanding because they were raised up in deception. Yah knows what he's doing, but it comes down to at this point in time, he's waking his people up. And so we have to learn and read and study the scriptures from a Hebraic perspective, the true Hebraic perspective. And we have to weed through the deceptions that we've been told in church.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly what it is.
So how do we reach the people? Like, what are we going to be doing? Because look, like, I am active in the ministry. You're active in the ministry and sharing your heart with the people that do choose to listen to you. So mm-hmm. How can we that are being used by Yah to minister to ourselves and each other, how can we reach the people, let's say, that are the Eve Mexicans that are out in Veracruz, Mexico, or don't even talk about Venezuela or Brazil. That's full of Eves. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That's full of Eve Israelites. So
right.
How do we reach them? Because some of them, they speak Portuguese, or they speak French, or they speak English in some cases, or you know, different things. How do we reach these people? Or like the city people, which I love the city people. I have a special place in my heart for the city people mm-hmm. of India and Pakistan. Yeah. How do we reach them?
Well, you know, that's for me, it's a two-part. I feel like we have a responsibility for being able to learning how to communicate with them. So, I mean, I do believe that, you know, to a degree, we will have to learn how to how to communicate in their language, or somebody that can translate for us. And then I also feel like once we're able to get that communication barrier broken down, for me personally, it makes sense to start with history because, you know, we've been so missionaryized. I know it's a made up word, but everybody has come with a new, with their God and saying, this is why you should believe in him and how to get to salvation. That I feel like if we lead in that, even though that's true, if we lead in that, it's a possibility to me that we might turn someone off because they're like, oh, I didn't hear everybody that said there's a God before. But if we can show them how your history, things that you can't deny, things that don't necessarily need faith for you to understand and to believe it, ties into this, because the Bible isn't just this, you know, like, I've heard people say it's fairy tale. It's not a fairy tale. Some of the stuff sounds like a fairy tale because nobody's believing and nobody's really walking like they should to see these things happen. But I mean, it sounds like a fairy tale, but it's not. It's actually very factual. It's played out and it's still playing out. And so I think that's how I feel like, you know, we should connect with them, show them why, you know, you're in Brazil or you're in, you know, Canada or Mexico, wherever you are, but you know, you didn't come from here, you know, even though our ancestors were there before the Europeans, the way I see it, you know, and I could be wrong. I'm open to learning if I'm, you know, wrong, but the way I see it, yes, we were in that place first, but we still originated from somewhere. You know, it wasn't just like, oh, the Mexican originated in Mexico, the African originated in Africa. And, you know, I mean, I feel like that person had to come from somewhere. And even though they ventured out, you know, that's where they ended up. But they still mm-hmm. originated from somewhere. So, you know, I feel like, okay. And then even in the cases modern day today, with those that have a history of slavery, that's even more evident that you came from somewhere else. You know, you came from somewhere else. So understanding, well, why is that my people went into slavery when nobody else did? And the scale that we did, you know? And that's how I feel like we should reach them. We need to reach them.
You know, I gotta say, I like that. And for anyone that's listening, if you speak Portuguese, if you speak French, if you speak German, honest, Arabic, if like whatever language you speak, get in contact with myself or Joe here and contact us. If you are, you know, even if you're, you know, if you're an Eve Israelite, or even if you're a Gentile and you want to help support the cause of awakening Yah's chosen people, if you can speak those languages and you're willing to help us in that, you know, contact us. You can contact me at duaneforchrist@gmail.com. That's DUANE, the number 4, christ@gmail.com. We definitely need to get active in, like you said, reaching the people with from a historical perspective. Because I was talking with an awesome lady. She's actually lives in London, and she's from the Mauritius Islands, but she lives in London. And she was discussing with me. She was doing some research, and I'm gonna help her with her research on the people of the Mauritius Islands. And yes, there are Eve Israelites that are in the Mauritius Islands. Mm-hmm. And check this out. According to her, and she is an actual person from you know, Mauritius Islands, they don't know where they came from.
Wow. That's just crazy. And I mean, I understand that, but it's also, it's it's crazy to see the scripture right there before you. Like, that's awesome to me.
They did not know where they came from. They know that they were brought over as slaves. That's about it.
Yes, that's the same narrative we all have. Because that's where it started. That's where it stopped and started.
It's amazing. So, but you know, this has been an awesome discussion. And I will go ahead and I'll merge the two audios together. I'll give a copy to you so you can use for your own personal use and for your YouTube page. Go ahead and give a plug out for your YouTube page and what people can expect from your channel.
Okay. Well, my YouTube page is Hebrew Gal, GYAL, kind of like the Caribbean flair, Joe. No, I'm not from the Caribbean necessarily, but I love it. And so I like that flair. So it's Hebrew Gal Joe. And on that page, I'm sharing, of course, the Hebrew every faith, but also I like to point out connections with our history, learning about people in our history, in our past that doesn't get the light that it should have got, they should have gotten, and also pointing out how we are connected, not just in Americas, because a lot of people like to tend to focus on the Black American, good or bad, but you know, we're not the only ones, you know, like there's a lot of us, like you said, in Brazil and all that stuff. So I'm working to, so I'm working to like point out how we're all the same in you know, Palestine and Jamaica and, you know, you know, we're all the same people, you know, and so that's kind of how I work to tie it all together from a practical standpoint, but with a spiritual, biblical, Hebraic foundation. So that's what you can expect from my page.
Amen. And that's just awesome. Please check out her page. And last thing that I want to do in closing is I would like us both to put out a call to our people to really come to a certain level of repentance. So for me, here's my heart to you that are listening right now. My heart is that if you are a Eve Israelite, man or woman, boy or girl, it's important to know who you are, because the world has told you that you are nothing, that you come from nowhere, and that your history starts on a boat in the 1600s. And that's not the case. You come from a long line of descendants, kings, queens, princes, and a royal priesthood. You have an entire nation of priests that are holy and chosen unto Yah. The Bible, the Holy Scriptures, are and is your history book. So if you want to know who you are, where you come from, that's your history book. If you want to know why you're in the condition you're in, go read the book of Deuteronomy. And I will say this, there's a lot of things that a lot of the colonialists saw and they witnessed in Africa that they thought were pagan or witchcraft. And literally it's taken right out of the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. And so it's important to understand that it's time to learn your culture and your history. And the truth is very, very deep. And I just pray that all of us repent of the sins of ourselves and the sins of our forefathers, because that's the reason why we're in the situation we are in today, because all of us were considered to be a part, the seed within our forefathers. When this covenant was struck back in the Deuteronomy, when the covenant was made, we were there. And so what happened then affects us now. Yeah. So we have to come together as a people in love. In love. Yah is a Yah Elohim of love, not hate, but love. So we have to come together in one accord, learn our history, and repent, because we've fallen short. Our forefathers had fallen short, and that's the reason why we went through the punishment we went through. But it's time to wake up, and it's time to come out. I'm ready to go home. I don't know about you, but it's time to go home. So any last words from you, Joe, and then we'll close out.
I completely ditto and agree with everything that he's saying. And then I also, I just feel important to say to those who are still in Christianity, is that I don't want to say like I don't want to make you feel like we're presenting a new doctrine to you. I mean, it may be new in the sense that you never heard it before, but basically I just want you to consider that the things that you're doing now, the Sunday worship and you know, those pagan holidays, those are the things that I have issue with. And I don't say I, but yeah, the scriptures has issue with, because they're not what he commanded us to do. So this is not taken away from your love for Yah or for your love for Jesus and the Lord and all that. But you have to understand that the scriptures commanded us to live our life. And so just take the time out. Don't jump on it because I said or anybody said it, but actually take the time out to actually have an ear to hear and search the scriptures and really see what it says. And don't read it with the mindset of what the understanding you've already felt like you had. Actually have a blank slate and read it and see for yourself. And then start, once you realize the truth, make that decision that day for yourself, who you're going to serve, you know, like the scripture says, and wake up, because like you said, I'm ready to go too. I ain't trying to build no fancy lifestyle here in America. Nope. I'm ready to go home. I am ready to leave like yesterday. Okay. Seriously. So, you know, we need to, yeah, like for real. I tell my mom every day, I'm ready to leave the country like right now. But Yah hasn't given me that unction yet. But you know, as for Israel, I want as many as us to come.
I'm getting passports ready. No.
Exactly. Look, if I need to give up citizenship, that's just where I am. Now, everybody else may not feel that unction, but if Yah leads, I'm on it. But it's just, this ain't my home, and I've never felt like it was my home. And so I'm ready to go and be at peace. Yes. You know, but I want Israel to come with us. And I don't want, you know, like you said earlier, Yah has no respect of persons. You know, he has chosen Israel out of all the other nations, but at the same time, he punished us just like he punished everybody else. But actually, we actually got it worse. But there's no respect of persons. So if you don't repent, if you don't follow this, as much as he loves you and wants you to be a part of that nation, he can't go against his word, and he will have to punish, like put you to death, so to speak, spiritually and physically. So that's why I want as much as us to come. Yeah, I want as much as us to come together and do that. But you know, it's your choice. But we need to wake up, because it's necessary. And the time is the earth is showing itself, and the Gentiles, you know, we have to have consideration for them as well. Without us being that light and bringing the truth to them, there is no salvation for them in a way. You know what I mean? So we can't just stay in our own ignorance, because we have a huge amount of blood in our hand if we don't. Like we signed a covenant. So I don't want to go on and on, but it's the same
thing. No, you're good. Because honestly, that's right. Because the covenant is no joke.
Yeah, it isn't. It's no joke. It's real deal. Like, it's serious. And you didn't make this with like Uncle Joe or, you know, Ronnie down the street. You're talking about the creator of the universe. So yeah, this is serious. And it's deeper than just, I do Christmas for the gifts. Great. Buy the Xbox on July. I mean, get it whenever you want to. Like, you know, I don't need to be in paganism just because I want to get a nice gift. My soul isn't, no, I'm sorry. I'm not gonna get into that, but no.
Go ahead.
But I see a lot of our people saying, I just do it for this. I know it ain't true, or, you know, it's just for fun. And it may be, but when you come down to, yeah, but when you come down to covenant, that's not, you know, you can't go to
fly.
Yeah, exactly. They don't fly. You know, you can't even bring that to the judge and say, well, I didn't pay my bill because I didn't pay my rent because I just didn't feel like it. You're going to be evicted, and they're going to put that on your credit. Like, that's just the bottom line. So it can't just be about fun and games. You have to seriously look at this and say, okay, well, this is real. I got to take this seriously. And can't just do your own thing in the sense of, I still love God, I'm good. It don't work that way.
That's right. Amen. So, and you've hit on a very key, important topic on this closing, because Yah has a standard. He has a standard, and he's not going to break his word. He's not going to break the law. And like I said, in 1 John, it talks about sin is lawlessness.
Yeah.
And yet that's what's happening every day, is that many Christians say they love Jesus, but they go on sinning. I've even heard them say, well, I'll get right later.
Yeah. Oh, God, yes.
We're like, what? You're going to die. You go straight die. You know, right. Different than you talking about, I'm going to go and enlarge my barn and, you know.
Like, yeah, the rich man.
Thou fool. Did you not know your soul is required of thee this night? Like, come on, man. Like, you can't sit there and bank on you got tomorrow. You know what I mean? Yeah. You can't do that. And there's no second chances. Yeah, we'll stop because we can transition this all night long. So we'll have to schedule more conversations and we'll have to get more of the brothers and sisters on. I think the topic of Christianity is important because I don't want the Christians to feel like they have to deny the Messiah.
Right, that's right.
And I know that as many people look into this truth because their heart is being plucked by this truth and they research and they see the crazy Power Rangers on the corner yelling and screaming. By the way, many of those dudes are government agents. So just so you
know. I've heard that so many times before. Yes.
Oh, it's legit. It's legit. To discredit the truth, they pander to YouTube and different video platforms. They don't like, they ain't got no audience except the camera. So they say the most outlandish and crazy things because it's designed to throw you off. Yeah. Most of those dudes are Masons.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of those dudes, they're just playing a role. So just don't even, the spirit of Yah is not upon them. So you already know where they're coming from.
Right. Like the scripture says, many will come in my name.
Right. Many antichrists are in the world. Come on now. So, you know, as you seek this truth, and I, you know, we both have a list of people that you can go to that will give you some good meat of the truth of the gospel, the kingdom. Okay. So be careful out there who you listen to. If you get the unction that they got an antichrist spirit, run. If they got an ABC in their name and they some kind of camp group with an ABC name, that ABC is backed by ABC intelligence agency. Shadow government move.
Yeah.
COINTELPRO. Come on now. I'll keep it real. So anyway, thank you very much for your time. It's very precious to have you here on this broadcast. And I appreciate you so much. I would like to end in prayer. So Father God, thank you for the many blessings that you bestowed upon us. Thank you for this knowledge and truth. Thank you for the understanding that you've bestowed upon us. Thank you for affording us the opportunity to bless our brothers and sisters in the faith. Not only our Eva Israelite brothers and sisters, but also many Christians around the world, as well as those that are coming out of other pagan religions and systems. Thank you for your ministering angels going forth, confirming this truth among the people, and that your spirit will move and they will get connected. They will get connected to other faith-filled believers and Eva Israelites that are able to speak and witness to this truth. So I thank you for it now, all that you're doing.
Thank you.
In Yah's holy name, in the name of HaMashiach. Yes. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. I enjoyed myself.
All right. You have a great night, all right?
Thanks. You do the same.
Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.